you will take your Bibles, go to the book of Joshua. We're in a series through the book of Joshua. We are with Joshua and his army as they go into Canaan to possess the land that God had given to them. I'll ask you a question. How big is your God? How big is your God? Maybe how big is your concept of God? Does your lack of faith limit what God can do? Hey, remember, the generation that come out of Egypt, they didn't have enough faith to enter into Canaan land, did they? And they all perished in the wilderness. They wandered 40 years and perished in the wilderness. Now, their children have grown up in the wilderness, and now it's their turn. And they enter in to conquer Canaan land and gain their possession. We've noted they defeated Jericho and Ai. Then they were deceived by the Gibeonites, who came in and made them think that they were from a far country. They made a league with the Gibeonites, and they were among the Canaanites. And so they disobeyed God in doing so, even though they were deceived. They should have prayed about it. God would have shown them. Now we get into chapter 10. We find five of the kings of Canaan that have joined forces, not only to fight Israel, but to destroy Gibeon. Because Gibeon had made an alliance with Israel, they want to take care of Gibeon and destroy them. So these five kings come together. And really, that's better for Joshua. Instead of beating them one by one, he gets to beat them all on time. Amen. So when the enemies of God come into an alliance to defeat us and fight us, we can deal with them as Joshua did. Folks, battles are reality. Now you may think, well, Brother West, enough already with Joshua and battles. Listen, there's so much we need to learn. We face battles every day. We battle the world. We battle the flesh. We battle the devil. And there are things we need to understand if we are going to have a victorious life here on earth. In the day of battle, God will be there. If we're walking with God, if we're in God's will, He will be there to give us the victory. He will fight the battle for us. As the Bible says in Psalm 46:1, He is an ever-present help in time of need. We're going to face battles. Spiritual battles. And we need to learn how to conquer our enemies. Ephesians 6:12 says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places. These are spiritual battles that we have to deal with. And we have spiritual weapons for this. Write this verse down. 2 Corinthians 10:4 says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're not of the world, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. With that in mind this morning, let's join the army of Israel and learn how to fight the good fight of faith. Joshua chapter 10, let's begin reading with verse number 6. And the men of Gibeon sent unto Joshua to the camp of Gilgal, saying, slack not thy hand from thy servants, come up to us quickly and save us and help us. For all the kings of the Amorites that dwell in the mountains are gathered together against us. So Joshua ascended from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of valor. And the Lord said unto Joshua, fear them not, for I have delivered them into thy hand. There shall not a man of them stand before thee. Joshua therefore came unto them suddenly, went up from Gilgal all night. And the Lord discomfited them before Israel, and slew them with a great slaughter at Gibeon, and chased them along the way that goeth up to Beth Horon, and smote them to Azekah and to Makkedah. And it came to pass, as they fled from before Israel, and were in the going down to Beth Horon, that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven upon them unto Azekah, and they died. There were more which died with the hailstones than they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword. We're going to stop there and notice as we go through this chapter some lessons. First of all, I want to talk to you about a lesson about the Savior. We want to know more and more about Jesus. Amen. We want to know all we can know about Christ and what he can do in our lives. Now, Israel had made a treaty with the Gibeonites and as an ally, now they must join in with them in battle. They are going to fight the enemies of Israel. There's three truths here I want you to see. First of all, in God dealing with them and giving them confidence and comfort, first of all, he gave them his peace. He says, fear them not. Fear them not. He says that to us today. We have enemies. But God says, don't fear your enemies. See, God's already conquered our enemies. God's conquered them. He conquered them at the cross. And he will be with there. He is going to be in control no matter what you have to face. Matt mentioned, you may not have liked the way the elections turned out. But I want to tell you something. It really doesn't matter. God's in control. As God was in control back then, I believe God is still in control today. He's still on the throne. He's still our God. And if we will follow him and walk by faith and not by sight, God will give us the victory. I do pray for revival in America. I pray that we've taken some steps here that might bring God back into our country and even our government. We need to pray for that. But the secret to walking in peace, folks, is walking in faith. Walk in faith. God, listen, God did not save you for you to live a life of worry and agitation. God saved you to give you his peace that you might live in victory over all things. Folks, listen, everything that happens here has to pass over God's desk. I didn't know God had a desk. Well, you learned something today, didn't you? Figuratively speaking, anything that happens, God must allow. Now, God sometimes allows bad things to happen, but he promises us he'll work that out for our good. He gave them his peace. He gives us his peace. Secondly, he gave them and he gives us his promise. Now, if you're holding the Word of God this morning, that's full of promises, isn't it? We have the Word of God, a word of encouragement. He gives us promises. The Lord did not save you to be defeated. He has promised you victory if you will walk with him. Now, that does not mean that everything in your life is going to go just the way you want it to go. You're going to face some problems. You're going to face some battles. But God does promise you that he will enable you to get through any circumstance that you may face. You can have victory over this world. You can have victory over the flesh. You can have victory over Satan. God shows us the way. Then thirdly, he gave them and he gives us his power. Verses 9 through 14, we read of what God did for them. Let's take up with verse 12. It says, then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, this is what Joshua prayed. Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hasted not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. Now he gave them his power. He did that in two ways. First of all, he sent a hailstorm that destroyed many of the enemy that Israel was fighting. Write this verse down in your notes. Job 38 and verse 22. There it says, "Hast thou seen the treasures of the hail, which I have reserved against the time of trouble, against the day of battle and war?" God can do some great things for us. If we're walking with God, if we're in God's will, there's ways that God can move and act to deliver us from anything. Then there was the sign in the heavens. There's this great miracle in regard to the physical world. Joshua makes an unusual prayer. Now, I have to believe that the Spirit of God moved him to do this. When he said, "I want the sun to stand still to give them extra daylight to finish up the battle." This was the first daylight savings time. They got an extra long day so that they could win the victory over their enemies. Now, there's a lot of people that just ridicule this story in the Bible. They say, you know, that's just impossible. That could not happen. If the sun stood still like that, there would be great tragic consequences all over this world. Not if God's in charge. God can do anything. Some of them say, well, you know, the idea of the sun standing still, and we know that the earth rotates around the sun. The sun does not move. They mock. But don't we use such terms as sunrise and sunset? Is that because we think the sun rotates around the earth? No, we know the earth rotates around the sun. But that's just language of observation. Even today, we talk about the sun rising and the sun setting. We know the sun doesn't move. So the same idea here. But then there's this idea, well, preacher, come on, listen. There's no way that could happen. Let me share something with you. Ancient history supports this claim. They've discovered that the Chinese, the Babylonians, the Incas, the Aztecs, the Egyptians, the Assyrians, and many other ancient cultures, they all record the existence of a long day in the time of Joshua. Every one of these in their history refers to a long day. I read that using an ancient Chaldean calendar system, which is built around the lunar and solar eclipses, I say it's possible to count forward to this day and find that this day that we're reading about here actually fell on a Thursday, July 22nd. They say now if you count backward using our system of reckoning days, you'll find that this event happened on Wednesday, July 22nd. There's a discrepancy here. One says it's Thursday, July 22nd. The other says it's Wednesday, July 22nd. There's a day missing somehow. Even in this calculation, they discover something happened, and it was in the time of Joshua that this happened. Years ago, there was a story about NASA trying to make some long-range calculations, and the models kept coming up flawed. Just wasn't working out. Then a Christian physicist factored in Joshua's missing day and added that, and the calculation worked out. Now, NASA denies that story. I'm not saying it's true, because it doesn't matter to me. I accept the word of God. If God wanted to have the sun stand still or an extra long day where the sun slows down, I don't know how he did it, but he did it. I have no trouble with that. I believe God can do anything. You said, but preacher, this violates the laws of nature. I got news for you. God does not obey the laws of nature. The laws of nature obey God. Now, in order to have a law, you got to have two things. You got to have somebody who's powerful enough to create the law, and you got to have someone powerful enough to enforce the law. Our Creator sustains this universe. He created it. He controls it. And God can supernaturally intervene at any time to alter the so-called laws of nature. I don't have a problem with that. I believe in a powerful God. Now again, it comes back to the question I asked you at the beginning. How big is your God? How big is your God? Well, my God's not big enough to do that. Well, I feel sorry for you, that you got a puny God. But my God's all powerful. I believe the story of Jonah and the whale. I believe the story of Noah and the flood. I don't have any problem believing what is supernatural in the Bible, because I serve a supernatural God. But God can't do this. He's not much of a God. I've seen God do some wonderful things. I've seen some lives transformed by the power of God. I've seen God work. You ever seen a car that was in a horrible accident and it's just mashed into pieces, and you wonder, how did anybody walk away from that? Get Betty and Donna to tell you, and Shelby, about the car wreck they were in. Betty loves to tell this story, because she said there's no doubt in her mind that the angels of God intervened to rescue and deliver them from that wreck. Me and Brother Bill went over there, and this was over in Memphis, Tennessee, and Bill and I went to get them. And we went to see that car. It was unbelievable. Anybody walked away from that? But they felt the angels of God with the arms around them to protect them. I don't have trouble believing that. You may laugh about it, not believe it, but I don't have any trouble believing that. How big is your God? How big is your God? Folks, it's sad that so many people have such puny God that cannot do anything. God is still on the throne. Jeremiah 32:27, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? There's a lesson about our Savior. Secondly, there's a lesson here about the saints. As we read on, I want you to see something. Let's take it with verse 16. These five kings fled and hid themselves in a cave at Makkedah. And it was told Joshua, saying, the five kings are found hid in a cave at Makkedah. And Joshua said, roll great stones upon the mouth of the cave and set men by it to keep them. And stay ye not, but pursue after your enemies and smite the hindmost of them. Suffer them not to enter into their cities, for the Lord your God hath delivered them into your hand. There's a lesson here about how to deal with our enemies. I'm going to go over some of the same ground that Matt covered last Sunday night when he's talking about the Gibeonites. I want to share the same three points again. Because not only is there a supernatural aspect of this, what God is doing, but there's also a personal aspect. There's things we must do. For God to act and God to prevail, we must be in the fight. First of all, we must control our enemy. Just as Joshua put these five kings in a cave and sealed them up there, preventing them from escaping. And there's a picture of control there. And I think that's true in our life. Folks, when you got saved, God redeemed you, but still we deal with the flesh. And those five kings represent to me the flesh. You've got to bring your body under subjection, the Bible says. You need to have control over the flesh. There's a part of you that still loves sin. You know that? Do you recognize that? That old sinful Adamic nature still wants to sin. And what you've got to do is that's hiding in you and just wants to run out into the open every once in a while to cause you trouble. Talk about the flesh. You probably have a besetting sin. It may be anger. It may be bitterness. It may be prejudice. It may be lust. It may be covetousness. But I'm going to tell you, that's something you need to get control of. And God will help you. Then you must confront your enemy. Notice that when they came back, Joshua returned to that place. Verse 21. Verse 22, then said Joshua, open the mouth of the cave and bring out those five kings unto me out of the cave. They did so and brought forth those five kings unto him out of the cave, the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, the king of Jarmuth, the king of Lachish, the king of Eglon. And it came to pass when they brought out those kings unto Joshua, that Joshua called for all the men of Israel and said unto the captains of the men of war which went with him, come near, put your feet upon the necks of these kings. They came near and put their feet upon the necks of them. Joshua said unto them, fear not, nor be dismayed. Be strong and of good courage, for thus hath the Lord do to all your enemies against whom you fight. He's trying to teach them something here. The enemies that you once feared, they're prostrate before them, and the princes come and they put their foot on their neck. That these have been subjugated to them. These have been defeated. And folks, the lesson, there's things in your life that you need to confront. You need to confront certain things and learn how to control these things. Secret sins, besetting sins, you can have the victory over these things. God wants you to. You know what you got to do? You got to drag these things out of their hiding place and put your foot on their neck. Don't let these things have dominance in your life. You'll never prosper until you do things God's way. Write this verse down, Proverbs 28, 13. Says, he that covers his sins will not prosper. If you cover your sins, you will not prosper. But whoso confesses and forsakes them shall have mercy. Control, confront, and conquer. Conquer your enemies. Joshua put these kings to death. Look at verse 26. And afterward, Joshua smote them and slew them, hanged them on five trees. They were hanging upon the trees till the evening. It came to pass at the time of the going down of the sun, finally went down. Joshua commanded, they took them down off the trees and cast them into the cave wherein they had been hid, and laid great stones in the cave's mouth, which remain until this very day, the day of this writing. Joshua put these kings to death. We've talked about this already, haven't we? You've been crucified with Christ. You are to put to death the things of the flesh and world. Let me give you this verse once again, Galatians 2:20. Paul summarizes this here in Galatians 2:20. He said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That's the way to live. That's what this whole book of Joshua is about. It's teaching us how to live a victorious life. Let me close with a lesson about our steadfastness. Going to chapter 11, you see Israel completing their campaign, going north and south to conquer. You see the temporal aspect of battle. These battles must be fought, but they don't last forever. Amen? Israel finally entered into a state of rest. One day, we will leave these battles behind us and enter into the rest of God. But let me share three quick truths in closing. First of all, while we're here, we're going to have to fight these battles, and we're going to have to fight them daily. We must fight daily these battles and these enemies. Israel fought day by day. It was a life of battles. They had to confront their enemies every day, and so do we. We must arise each day to fight our battles faithfully for the glory of the Lord. So, preacher, I'm praying for easier times. I don't want to face my enemies. I don't want to go into battle. Well, I'm sorry, but you're there. And as long as you're on this earth, you're going to have to deal with these things. The only day you have to fight the battle is today. Tomorrow may never come. What I'm saying is, you say, well, I want to put these things off. I don't want to deal with them now. I'll deal with these things later. I'll deal with my sinful habits later. I'll deal with my sinful attitudes later. Look, I'll remind you, all you've got is today. You don't have tomorrow. You have no promise of tomorrow. Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for you know not what a day may bring forth. All you've got is today. And you need to win the victories today. We must fight them day by day. Listen, if there's something you need to do for Christ, you need to do it today. If there's something you need to give to the cause of Christ, you need to do it today. If there's somebody you need to talk to about Jesus, you ought to do it today. You don't have tomorrow. Some of you are not saved. If you die today, die without Christ, you die without hope. According to the Bible, you'll be cast out into eternal darkness. That's not God's will. It's not God's will that any should perish. God made a way of salvation. But he says in the Bible, today's the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. The Bible says, Isaiah 55:6, call upon the Lord while he is near. He's near today. He may not be tomorrow. Don't put this off. Second, we must fight with determination. It says in chapter 11, verse 18, Joshua made war a long time with all these kings. A long time. Many years they had to fight these enemies. But Joshua had determination. Joshua was not going to quit till the job was done. You know what's wrong today? Too many so-called Christians have quit. They've quit. They've quit coming to church. They've quit serving the Lord. They've quit living for Christ. Listen, we must stand fast in these last days. Write this verse down. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Here it says, be ye steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Be steadfast. Don't quit. I mean, when you get home, just take out your dictionary and just cross quit out of it. And while you're at it, cross compromise out. They're both under K, right there together. Don't quit. Amen. Too many have quit and gone back. How big is your God? Will he see you through to the end? Donald Gray Barnhouse was a well-known preacher. Authored many books on Bible commentaries. I read that one time he went back to his alma mater, back to Princeton. He was invited to speak in chapel. His old Hebrew professor was seated right in front of him on the front row to hear him. Afterwards, they were talking, and his professor said, "You know, I like when my boys come back that were in my class, I like to come and hear them speak. I want to know if they are big Godders or little Godders." He said, "Some of them have a little God. Their God cannot give us the inspiration of the Scriptures. Their God cannot preserve the Scriptures for us. Their God can do nothing supernatural." But he says, "Son, I'm so glad to hear you preach a great God. You're a big Godder, and God will bless your ministry." Are you a big Godder? Or are you a little Godder? Your little God can't do anything. I believe in a God that can make the sun stand still. Y'all pray for me. That's just where I'm at. Then finally, we must fight with devotion. Fight with devotion. He says in verse 15, chapter 11, "As the Lord commanded Moses, his servant, so did Moses command Joshua, and so did Joshua. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses." Look at verse 23, the last verse. "So Joshua took the whole land according to all the Lord said unto Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance unto Israel according to their divisions by their tribes, and the land rested from war." Joshua was devoted, and he finished the job he had been given. That's the way to live. Our duty, folks, is to love him, to walk in his word, and to serve him faithfully until God takes you home. There's never a time to quit. Let me give you a couple of verses here you might want to jot down. Micah 6, verse 8. "He has showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee? But to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God." You ought to have that verse highlighted or underlined in your Bible. Let me add another one. Ecclesiastes 12, 13. There it says, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter." That's what you've been waiting for, is a conclusion, right? Here you go. "Fear God. Keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man." One day the battles of this life will be over. Christ will come for us, take us home. But friends, until then, we've got work to do. There's things we need to do in serving our Lord. We can't surrender. We've got to fight the good fight of faith. I hope that when you come to the end of your life, you can say what Paul said. Paul said this at the end of his life, recorded in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Now, I want you to listen to this. And I want you to honestly ask yourself, could I say this? If this is the end and God is about to take me home, could this be my epitaph? Listen to this. Paul says, "For I am now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight." He's a fighter. "I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I've kept the faith." henceforth there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. Not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. Would that be true of you? Have you fought a good fight? Have you kept the faith? I pray that God will use this message to encourage you, that you might continue on.